Hey there, welcome to Excel Campus. My name is John, and in this video, I'm going to explain how to create this dashboard report on an older version of Excel. So this was our submission for the Excel hash competition, which we won, by the way, so thank you for voting. And for that competition, we had to use four main ingredients in order to create a solution in Excel. So this is a solution I came up with. Those ingredients that we had to use are relatively new features for Excel. We had the XOR function, which was introduced in Excel 2013. We also use dynamic arrays, which are only available for Office 365 and the very latest channel of Office 365. I also use the XLOOKUP function, which is only available on Office 365 as well. So we got some great feedback about this dashboard. However, a lot of people said that they couldn't use any of these features yet because they're not on the latest version of Excel. And I totally understand that. I totally get that. I've worked for employers that didn't have the latest version of Excel either, and I understand some of those frustrations. However, we can create this on an older version of Excel, the exact same report, just using some different tools and features. So here's the report here, and it uses pivot tables, as well as some different formulas and features of Excel. So I'm gonna go through this and break these down to show how we can still create this interactive dashboard using an older version of Excel. All right, so we're first going to start on the data sheet. And this is the source data, all the data we have for this report. And if you haven't seen any of the previous videos yet in this series where I'm breaking down how I created this dashboard, I recommend at least watching part one because that'll explain exactly what this data is and how it works. It's a parody on my favorite TV show, The Office, where Dwight's installed a security system and is tracking attendance based on when people come into or go out of the building. So we need to do some calculations on this. And in the original file, we use the XOR function to determine if the employee was coming into or going out of the building because we don't have that information. So with that, we were using that function really to determine or count the number of times the employee name is listed here in the table. And if that was an odd number, that meant they were coming into the building. If it was an even number, that meant they were going out of the building because the data here is in chronological order. So at the end of that video, and I recommend watching that video on the XOR function. Again, that function's available in Excel 2013 and later. At the end of that video, I said you could also use COUNTIF and ISOD. You could use those two functions in place of XOR. So that's what we're doing here. And as you can see in this formula, we're actually using ISEVEN instead of ISOD. And I'll explain why, but basically what's happening is we need to sort this data in a descending order from newest to oldest instead of oldest to newest. So in the previous version, we sorted from oldest to newest. And this one, we're flipping that sort order. And that's because we, for the next step, we need to use VLOOKUP instead of XLOOKUP. So in the original file, we used XLOOKUP, which is a new lookup function. And XLOOKUP has a feature that allows us to search in reverse order. It's the search mode is one of the parameters, one of the arguments there for XLOOKUP, where we can search in reverse order. So check out the previous video on that as well. I explain all of that. But for this solution, since we're using an older version of Excel and we don't have VLOOKUP, or I'm sorry, we don't have XLOOKUP, we can use VLOOKUP instead. And we're using that lookup to calculate the duration. So here's the VLOOKUP formula here, the basic VLOOKUP formula. And it's just looking up the employee name from this current row and then looking in the range below it for that same name and returning the date and time. So in this case here, we'd be looking for Creed. And since VLOOKUP looks vertically going down, it can only look vertically going down. That's why we have the data in that reverse order. With XLOOKUP, we can actually look going up, again, from bottom to top. Therefore, we could sort the data in a different order and it would work just fine. But here we have to be a little bit more specific with the sort order. So that's what we're doing here. So it's just looking down until it finds Creed again. And then once it finds that entry, then it'll return that time right here. So that's what this is. And then of course we did some math on that to take that from the current time in the current row. We have the previous time, and that gives us the duration that Creed was in the office for this particular time he was in the office. So just this increment, of course there's multiple rows for each employee, then we add that up to get their total duration or the total number of hours they're in the office for the week. And here's the duration calculation here in column E. For this, we're just only taking the duration when the employee has gone out of the building, not when they're going in the building. So that's why we have the if function starting it out here. And then we're also using this index function for our structured references. I explained that in the video on both XOR and XLOOKUP. So check out those videos if you want to learn more about that referencing there for tables or for structured references. That's a running total reference. So check that out. And then we multiply that by 24 to just get the number of hours. Otherwise, the math just gives you a fraction of a day. Multiply it by 24 to get the number of hours. So again, that's the total duration there in column E. And then in column F, we just do a lookup for the employee's department. That's to table on the employee's sheet over here. So that's just a simple VLOOKUP formula. And then here in column G, we have this distinct employee count calculation. And this we're going to use for our pivot table that will allow us to do a distinct count. So if you're on Excel 2010 or earlier and you don't have Power Pivot, Power Pivot would also allow you to do a distinct count. If you don't have that yet, then we can still kind of do that math in the source data range. And that's what we're doing here with a very simple formula that's just one divided by the count of the number of times the employee name exists in column A. So that's just going to give us a fraction. And when we add all those fractions up, that number will equal one. And then we can use that to calculate the average, kind of the average of the sums of total duration. And I'll explain that as we jump into the pivot tables. All right, so next we're going to look at the calculations. So in the original file here, we had a list of employees and the number of hours they worked. And we used some of the new dynamic array functions to do these calculations. We use the filter function. They're here on the calc sheet along with the unique function, and then the sort and sort by functions. Combine that with the sum if, which isn't a new function, but we use sum if to do the calculation of the duration and come up with this dynamic range. And this range changes as we filter by department. So we select a different department. What's viewed or listed here in this range changes using the new dynamic array functions. Now, if you're on an older version of Excel, you don't have that functionality. However, this functionality can be created with a pivot table. So we'll jump back over to the other file and I'll explain how this works. So we're just going to select any cell in this range here, insert pivot table, and we'll put that on a new sheet. And what we want to see first is just a sum of duration by employee. So with the pivot table, we can simply just take the employee, put it in the rows area. We can take the duration, put it in the values area. And now we have a list of all the employees along with the duration, the total number of hours they worked. Of course, you can go change the number formatting here and clean this up. But very simply, we've created that report right here. Now, if we want to filter down by department, we can do that by just taking the department field and putting that in the filters area. So now here we can just hit the dropdown, select a different department, and we'll just see those employees and their sum of total duration right here. So without using any formulas at all, we can create the same basic functionality with a pivot table, which is super cool. Now, we also want to calculate the total average by department, really, because that's another metric that was shown on our dashboard, and that's how we had those icons appearing. If the goal or the total average for the department was greater than the goal, we showed a firework, and if it was less than the goal, then we showed a storm cloud icon, because that's what Michael wanted to see on the reports. So in order to do that, we can actually use another pivot table. So I'm going to go ahead and clear the filter here, just show all. I'm going to just select all the cells in this pivot table. I'll hit Control C to copy that. And right over here, we'll hit Control V to just paste. We're just going to duplicate the pivot table. You can put it on a new sheet. I'm just going to keep it on this sheet to keep it easy. And then what we want to do here is we'll still leave the employee name here in the rows area. But instead of sum of duration, I'm going to remove that from the values area. And we're going to take our distinct employee count and put that in the values area. Now, again, if we go back to the source data, we had this fraction here, which was just one divided by the count of the number of employees in the column here, or just this employee's name for each row. So that gives us that fraction that adds up to one. So what we really want to do with that, as we jump back over to the pivot table, is just have a one here for each employee. And then as we filter down, then we'll only see the total number of employees based on the department filter. And then we can take that total number, divide it by this to get our average. Before we do that, as you'll probably know here, if we just went and filtered this by department, this pivot table is not going to be filtered. We need to link these together, and we can do that with a slicer. So just select either of these pivot tables, go to the pivot tables analyzer options tab, insert slicer. We'll insert that slicer for the department. So that'll insert our slicer here, right click that, report connections, and then we want to connect both of these. Now I have some other pivot tables in this workbook, but just both of these pivot tables here on sheet 6, we're going to connect both of those to the slicer, hit okay, and now if we either slice here or we filter within the dropdown, that's going to change both pivot tables, so it keeps them connected. And then from here we can calculate our average. So I'm just going to move this slicer over a bit. We'll give us some space over here, and that average is going to be equal to this cell here. And when we click that, you can see we get the GetPivotData function. And this is going to give us the total duration, that grand total duration based again on the filter for the pivot table. And we're going to divide that by this number here, which is the total number of employees, the distinct count of employees, again using that GetPivotData function. So this is going to calculate our average. So we hit enter there. That's the average number of hours worked for the employees based on the department selected. So we use the filter here, either the slicer or the filters. We can clear that out. We can see the total there is 35.08. If we drill down to just customer service, 35.68, and so on. So that's how we can calculate that average that again we'll use on the dashboard for our icons. And then here is the final calc sheet, which has the same pivot tables on it. It also has the average calculated here, which we just saw, as well as a goal, and then a few formulas for the labels that we also have on the dashboard, which I also explained in the previous video series on how these work. The thing that's different about this one is the icons, because if we jump back over, let me pull up the other file. Here it is here. With this one, we use these conditionally formatted icons. A bit of a crazy solution here, using the new icons in Excel, then cutting them out to making them to make them transparent, using some conditional formatting in the cell behind these icons, behind these shapes here, to then show depending on if the department had a good or bad performance. So I have a whole nother video that breaks that down, so I won't go into that here. We don't have those icons and the ability to make them transparent in older versions of Excel. So we have to use a different solution for this. So I'll jump back over to our other report. If we go to the shapes sheet in this file, you'll see it looks pretty blank. And that's because all we have here actually is somewhat of a similar setup using that paste linked picture feature. However, here I just have a few white rectangles that have a white transparent fill. So if we right click one of these, and choose, oops, that might be off your screen. Sorry if that's off your screen there. We're gonna choose format shape, or you can hit control one on the keyboard to bring up the format shape pane. And for the fill here, we have a solid fill color of white, and then we have a transparency set to 15%. So you can do 10 to 15%. All this is doing is that we're overlaying this shape. Eventually, if we jump over to the dashboard here, we're overlaying it over these icons. So these icons you can get online. I use a site called iconfinder.com, which has free icons. It's a great site. I'll put a link in the description below this video where you can check that out. Or you can even get these from the Microsoft Clip Art Gallery. There's a ton of places where you can get icons like this. But these are just two icons and they both have color. And then we have this transparent white rectangle over them. So I can move this off and you can actually see there, that's the shape. And then we have this transparent white rectangle over those. Let me hit Control Z there. So how do we set this up? Well, this is definitely a bit of an advanced solution, but I'll do my best to explain it. Over here on the calc sheet, we have a formula here that's just going to return a 1 or a 2. So if the average is greater than the goal, that means the performance is good. We have the good label, and we're going to return a 1. If the average is less than the goal for the department that's selected, then we're going to return a 2. So this 1 and 2 is used as an index in a named range. So we'll go over to the formulas, name manager, control F3 is the keyboard to open this. And I've defined two named ranges here. First one is for the firework. And you can see there's a formula used. Instead of referring directly to a specific cell or range for this named range, we're actually using the index function. And the range, the array for that index function is cells A1 and A2 on the shapes sheet. And then we're using that calc number, the 1 or the 2, to determine which cell to return. So if it's a 1, meaning it's good, then we're going to return cell A1. If it's a 2, we're going to return cell A2. So that's what's happening with this function. And then the storm cloud named range formula is the same. It's just referencing column B or B1 to B2 instead of A. So if we jump over to the shape sheet, here in A1, we have nothing. There's no shape here. In A2, we have that shape. Again, that's just that white rectangle that's transparent. And in B, we have the shape here. So for the bad performance, we have it here in B. And for B2, we have nothing there. So that's really going to do a toggle there. As the performance gets good or bad, it's going to toggle whether or not we see that shape. And what we're doing for that is if we just copy this cell here, we'll just copy cell A1. We'll go over to the dashboard, and I'm just going to right click somewhere here, do paste special, and then paste linked picture. That's going to paste this linked picture in here. I'll put it down here. And you can see that that's currently pointing to shapes A1. So we just created a picture that points to that cell, that specific cell. Instead of pointing to that cell, we're going to point to that named range. So we're going to reference that named range here. We can do that for the firework or the storm cloud. Those are the two named ranges we created. So I'll tab into that and hit enter. And then this is now going to show or display either cell A1 or cell A2, which contains that transparent shape, depending on the performance. So if we put it over the firework here, you'll see there's currently nothing there because we're having a good quarter. This department's having good performance. But if we choose a department that has poor performance, you can see now there's actually two shapes over that, so there's double transparency. But that's now being displayed. That shape is now being displayed in this linked picture. It's now displaying cell A2 and showing that that shape right there. So we'll go ahead and delete that one because we don't need it, because we have another one there as well. And again, you can see that shape is just pointing to that named range, which is using that index function to dynamically return either one of those cells that could be blank or that contains the shape that kind of grays out the icon here. And then for the final setup of the dashboard, we also have some text boxes that again are linked to the calc sheet, so you can see those here. So that's going to display the information on the calc sheet here, and this uses an if function to return the result, the average, if it's a good performance, and if not, it'll just return a blank, and if it's bad, it'll return the result here. If not, it's blank. So that's what these text boxes do here. There's text boxes here as well that you just can't see. I explained all that in a previous video as well, that setup, so check that out. And then I copied the pivot table with the employees here and their number of hours. I'll just clear that filter. I just copied that from the calc sheet. So just take this pivot table, select it all, or not that one, this one here, copy that pivot table, and then place that on the dashboard sheet here. And then it just went and changed the design to just a more minimalist design here for the pivot table. And that's really about it. I also added the slicer here. I copied and pasted the slicer. And then one thing when you do that, you want to make sure that the slicer is connected to the pivot table on this sheet, which is the dashboard sheet, as well as both of the pivot tables on the calc sheet. So everything's connected there and our averages will calculate properly to that distinct count pivot table as well. So you have all that there, and we still have this nice dynamic and interactive dashboard report, and we don't necessarily need all those new features and functions of Excel. That's not to say that those features aren't cool. They're all very cool new features and I love them, but I don't want you to feel left out if you're on an older version of Excel and you don't have those yet. And it's also just cool to see how Excel can accomplish so many tasks and solve so many problems in so many different ways with all of the features we have. There's probably plenty of other ways to go about this solution as well with different tools in Excel. So if you have any ideas for that, of course, please leave a comment below. We'd love to hear those. And if you have any questions or suggestions, please leave a comment below as well. Thanks again for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.